Welcome to Cosmetic Networks Live, where we explore the aesthetic and the cosmetic industry from the inside out. Hi, I'm your host, Sheila Maitland, and this is episode 98. Our special guest today is Dr. John Perlman, board-certified plastic surgeon from Beverly Hills. Welcome, Dr. Perlman.
Thank you, Sheila. It's nice to be here with you today.
We're so glad you're on the show. We have some great topics today. We're going to talk about the season of bathing suits, travel, and even weight loss and weight gain. So let's first start out, though, with liposuction and how liposuction is a big asset for those who are wanting to get into their bikinis this season. But please share with the viewers, what exactly is liposuction?
Well, you know, liposuction is one of those popular topics this time of year. Everybody's starting to think about getting into bathing suits and being outdoors and wondering and maybe even worrying about how they're going to look after the winter has passed. So many people are thinking about body sculpting, and liposuction is a great opportunity to remove fat that you can't do otherwise with exercise and diet. So if there's an area such as the grab handles or the hip rolls or the saddle bags, or maybe it's the fat under the chin, that can be removed in a very short period of time quite safely with generally excellent results.
So if a person's wanting to get into that bathing suit and is really just getting into the beginning of summer, what kind of time do they need from when they have that procedure done until when they can be back in that bathing suit and out on the beaches?
Well, generally, it takes about a week to 2 weeks for the initial recovery. But the results actually improve over 3 to 6 months' time. But most people have no bruising after about a week or 10 days, if they get any bruising at all with the modern techniques that we have. So the more time you have, the better, but it can be done and you can be back in a bathing suit within 2 weeks.
So then what kind of compression do they need to wear for that? And what are the most common areas of the body that you use the liposuction where those compressions might be needed?
Well, very often people who have extra fat in their trunk, the stomach and the hip roll area, as well as saddlebags, will benefit from having compressive garments worn for maybe a 4 week period after the procedure. But they can be taken off. People can go to the beach and come home and then put on their compression garments if they wish to. And it's not essential, but it does speed the recovery. So it's a nice way to make it an easier and quicker recovery.
Well, that's encouraging, because I think some of these last minute beachgoers, you know, you've realized, oh my gosh, get a new suit. And you go to the stores and you try on your suit in those horrific lighting and you realize, I need more work done. I got to talk to someone. I have to talk to Dr. Perlman.
How unfortunate.
Yeah.
That is.
Well, that's encouraging that 2 weeks they can still be back on the beach.
Exactly. And it's an easy recovery. There's discomfort for about 5 or 10 days, but it's really not that bad. It's really not that bad a recovery, and people can really benefit from it and feel good about how they look in that bathing suit or in shorts or other clothing.
So what about iLipo? What is iLipo and how does it differ?
iLipo is a really nice technique that's pain-free, that opens the fat cells, opens pores in the fat cells and empties the fat cell. One has to watch one's diet, one has to exercise to burn off those free fatty acids that are liberated, but it's sending the body the signal that's just the same as if you were running a marathon and you need a fuel source. So one lies under this low-power diode laser light for about 20 minutes, and then exercises and drinks a lot of fluid and takes inches off. Usually we recommend between 6 and 10 treatments. And with that, people have lost, in my experience, between 1 and 5 inches, depending upon how thick the layer of fat is that they have.
So is that something they should try first before they actually go into more of a invasive
surgical
procedure, like a surgical procedure?
Well, I find that some people come into my office and they say, I really don't want to have surgery. I don't want to have anesthesia. I'll accept less than the ideal benefit and less than an immediate benefit. So whereas liposuction probably removes, in my experience, about 80% of the thickness of the fat layer under the skin, with iLipo XL, I find between 40 and 60% of it is reduced. It's painless, it's perfectly safe, and there's no recovery. So some people want the best result they can get as quickly as possible, and those should have liposuction, and I explained that to them. And others would rather accept a little bit less but have an easier course without any surgery or anesthesia.
So how many procedures of the iLipo does a patient need to get the full benefits?
Depends upon how thick the layer of fat is, but generally speaking, we recommend between 6 and 10, on average about 8. I've had some patients who are very large who had a fabulous result with just 6 treatments. Others seem to take a little bit more and continue to benefit from the treatments, and they come in for 10. I've also seen patients come back a year, 2 years later, who have gained weight and none of it has gone back, in my experience, to the areas that we've treated with the iLipo machine. That's very impressive.
Wow.
I think the fact that it'll be a long-term result for most people makes it really advantageous.
Well, that's exciting to know, because I've heard that when you have liposuction, that area does not necessarily gain weight as it had in the past, because
Correct.
Those fat cells are removed.
That's
so
exactly
you're
right.
Having the same result with an iLipo. That's exciting.
Yes, following patients 2 to 3 years out, I've yet to see the fat come back to that area. It probably eventually will, because the fat cells are still there. But we also tell our patients to keep the weight off, not to consider this a replacement for diet and
right.
healthy lifestyle and exercise. So if you don't gain a lot of weight, I don't think you really have to worry about it. How long it will last, it's unclear, but it's in the years, I'm pretty confident.
Mm. So I understand there's a lot of athletic people that come in for liposuction, and they're thin build. So who is a candidate for something like that?
It's interesting. I've had several trainers who come in, and they exercise fastidiously. They're in the gym every day, but they find that there's just an area that's resistant. They can't get rid of that fat. And for those patients, the option of either iLipo treatment or liposuction is a good one. And the level of satisfaction after the procedure is enormous in those people because they know they watch their calories, they're in the gym hours a day, and they still can't get rid of that area. And to have somebody help them to accomplish
right.
that in a short period of time is very gratifying to them and to me as well.
Right. Well, you know, we're on the topic of bathing suits and travel also, because this is the season for travel as well. But let's roll into breast augmentation and first share with the viewers what is breast augmentation and who might be a candidate for one.
Well, there's many, many women who either never enlarged to the size that they'd like and had a feeling of having good proportioning. And there are others who had that shape, but then through aging, pregnancies, weight gain, weight loss, have lost it. So to restore fullness, we can put in breast implants, generally either saline or the more popular silicone gel implants. The latest version of which is a cohesive silicone gel implant, the type where if you cut it in half with a knife, it doesn't seem to go anywhere. So we've had really good results with those because they give a natural feel to most patients. But for somebody who just feels like their proportioning isn't ideal, they've maybe lost some of their breast volume, maybe they feel a little empty and droopy, putting in breast implants can be wonderful. It creates some of the happiest patients that we have.
So a patient wanting breast augmentation to get into that new bikini for the beaches this summer, what kind of timeline do they need to be thinking in their mind of when, from when they have their procedure to when they can be on the beach?
Well, they can be on the beach within 10 days to 14 days under normal circumstances. The thing I don't have my patients do is exercise and swim and do body, you know, upper body weightlifting. So you can be at the beach, but don't be doing push-ups, don't be carrying heavy bags. Because the initial 6 weeks of healing is when the membrane that the body forms around the implant, called the capsule, is developing. And if there's too much exercise, if there's a little swelling or bleeding, it can stimulate capsule contracture, which is something we want to avoid. So I like to stack the odds in my patient's favor of getting a good, soft, natural result by having them minimize their upper body exertion. But at the beach, probably in 2 weeks.
Wow, that's good information, and that's exciting for someone that's just a little bit behind summer because it's creeping up on us fast.
It is indeed. But having a nice figure in a bathing suit, it's as good as money can buy.
Yep, it is really great. Now, here's one more thing. Are the patients wanting to travel? Now, is there a difference in timeline of getting on the beach compared to getting on a plane?
Well, I explained to my patients, a fair number of them come from out of state and want to get back home. The question is, question pops up and I'm not there to be with them to examine them, how would they feel about that? So I prefer to have my patients stay in Los Angeles for at least 2 weeks, and if everything is going well, then they can travel and take a trip.
Let's talk about breast size implants and how a patient might pick that breast size. Do you have some special techniques that you help your patient when choosing the right size for them?
Well, I generally listen to what the patient has to say, and then I like to show them pictures of other patients, because that's reality.
Mm-hmm.
Because the potential in each individual is different. If you've had two kids and you want to go from a small B to a small D, it's probably feasible. But if you've never had children and you have a limited amount of skin, a small surface area of the breast, that's not going to create a natural look. And my priority is to really achieving good proportioning, but good appearance also. Just to achieve a full C at the price of having an unnatural look, I don't think is a good choice.
Mm-hmm.
So I work with the patient to get an understanding of what their goal is. I ask them if they'd like to be round or more a teardrop shaped, and then I tell them what range I think we can achieve. During the surgery, we put in test implants. Of course, the patient's asleep, so I can see about what size range and what the shape is like, and that's when I make my final decision. I do not pre-select an implant. I don't think it's a good idea to have a patient stuff a bra or a bathing suit top and then tell me that's the size that they want, because it looks so different when the implant's inside rather than when it's on the outside.
Right. You know, I love how you just said that you don't pre-choose or pre-select an implant before surgery and use a sizer. The great part about that is you have to know your patient. It is a very boutique practice. When you know your patient well enough, you know what they're wanting. And so you just work it out until it's exactly what they've described.
I think having an understanding of the patient's desires and expectations is so important. And it takes one-on-one exposure to the patient and conversation to get a good feeling. Because my goal is to make my patients as happy as possible. It's good for them, and frankly, it makes my life a lot easier also. If somebody wants something that's unrealistic or perhaps ill-advised, I'd rather tell them I'm not comfortable doing their surgery. And sometimes that impresses them, and they go, well, maybe I should reconsider. Other times, they might want to go try to find another doctor to do it for them.
You know, a couple things I've heard on the flip side of it, both of this, is I've heard that sometimes if you get too large of breast implants, it can make you look heavy. But then I've also heard physicians say the biggest complaint we have in our practice is that women say they didn't go big enough.
Well, I've heard both, and I think they're both true. Some patients feel if they're large busted, they proportion themselves better, maybe their backside is less noticeable. Others kind of feel that it makes them heavy, so it's an important issue. And there are some patients, and a lot of women will tell their girlfriends before they come in for a consultation, go a little bigger than you think you want. So it's my job to sense, is somebody being overly conservative or overly aggressive? And as I said, my goal is to make sure they have the best chance of being happy with the result. So we have to spend some time considering those different options that are available to them.
So let's roll into more of the face and maybe chemical peels and facelifts. But what's the best time of year to actually address the face when we're talking about facelift and chemical peels?
Well, facelifts can be done any time of the year. That's not an issue. But a chemical peel or a laser peel, depending upon how aggressive it is, and the more aggressive, the more reluctant I'd be to do it in the summer, especially if the patient wants to be outdoors. So some people live an outdoor lifestyle. You can see they come in, they've got a lot of sun damage, and they're not going to give that up as much as I advise them against it. But doing a chemical peel, which can cause some inflammation in the healing period, can be dangerous if you're going to be out in the sun because it can cause pigmentation. There's something called post-inflammatory hyperpigmentation where the skin is a little red, you go out in the sun and the ultraviolet turns on those pigment-producing cells and people can end up with blotchy discoloration, which nobody wants. So if you're having a chemical peel other than a very light one, it may be best to put it off until the fall or winter if you're not going to really be careful to avoid that sun exposure.
I see. So if a patient does come in and has chemical peels throughout the winter and maybe even lasers, and they've been through the healing process and they go back out into the sun that next summer, are they less tendency to have any type of hyperpigmentation?
Well, if enough time has passed that there's no inflammation in the healing, then they are less likely to have that problem develop. But fundamentally, if you're going to be out in the sun, you're damaging your skin. If you want your skin to look good, we have to impress upon our patients that one of the important factors is avoiding sun exposure. That's the number one cause of wrinkling and aging in the skin, more even than your age. I see patients who are in their 70s who you can tell they've never suntanned or sunburned, and their skin looks awesome, looks terrific. I've seen others who are in their 40s or 50s, and you can just see the years of sun damage is cumulative. You can't say when I hit 55, I'm going to stop going out in the sun. The damage has already been done. Right. So it's an important thing for people to keep in mind. And part of my job is to guide my patients. If they want to look good as long as they can, there are certain things you do and certain things you avoid.
Right. So if a patient comes in and they want a facelift, they just really need to get rid of some of that excess skin and tighten up, do you sometimes implement face chemical peels and lipo? Let me re-ask that question. So, Dr. Perlman, when a patient comes in for a facelift,
yes,
and they really could use some surface type of treatment as well, like a chemical peel or a laser, will you implement that at the same time that you're doing a facelift, or is that a separate type of procedure at a different time?
In my practice, based on my 30 years experience, I separate the two most of the time. And the reason is if you're lifting the skin and pulling on it, you're challenging the circulation a little bit. And to do an aggressive laser or chemical peel on that same skin, I think is risky. Mm. Some people do it, but I think generally you have to tone down the peel. I will do a peel around the mouth or around the eyes at the same time as a facelift because those areas are not being lifted simultaneously. So for most of my patients who really need good skin reconditioning, mm-hmm. I tell them to wait 3 months, 4 months after their facelift and then come in for a full strength laser peel or a chemical peel.
So who is a candidate for a chemical peel?
Well, anybody who's had sun damage. You know, there are chemical peels that are very aggressive and deep, and there are chemical peels that are very light, and most that we use nowadays are in between. Mm-hmm. So almost anybody over the age of 30 or 35 could benefit from a light chemical peel just to exfoliate and improve the fine wrinkles and reverse some of the sun damage. As we get older, we want to be more aggressive with those peels. So anybody with deep wrinkles, pigment spots, can use a maintenance program. And some of the new peels now mix combination of lower concentration peeling agents, mm. which makes it a mild to moderate peel, but a safe one. And the results have really been natural and very good.
I've heard about the Madonna peel, and I don't know how much that we've discussed it, but that it's when a patient comes in and they do a lot of small treatments over a longer period of time so they don't have that downtime. And so can you do that same type of thing within a chemical peel where you said less?
Yes, we do, as a matter of fact. It's very popular now, and I think for good reason. The recovery is easier. It's usually 2 or 3 days. Mm-hmm. It's gentle, and the risks are less. If you do an aggressive peel, there's a risk of losing color in the skin permanently. There's a risk of scarring. Why do that? Why not just maintain, have an easier recovery, but have a few peels a year?
So you're going to get the same results just over maybe a longer period of time and not so strong of a recovery time.
Correct. Now, somebody who's got 70 years of age and 50 years of severe sun damage probably does need something more aggressive like a fractionated laser peel. But for most people, I think maintenance and skin protection, the use of good moisturizers, vitamin C, other good quality products can really keep your skin in top shape. It's something that we should all be paying attention to, especially those of us living in an environment like we have here in Southern California or Arizona, New Mexico.
So what age should a person start to consider? Maybe I need to go in and start having peels done to prevent the aging process.
I would think somebody wants to be a step ahead should consider, first of all, should be using sunblock from their teen years on permanently, but also a light chemical peel perhaps in the early 30s. And a lot of people are coming in for Botox and fillers, mm-hmm. so there's a heightened awareness of what's available to prevent skin damage and decrease aging. So it's much more popular now for people to think ahead and to try to prevent those deep wrinkles.
That's great. Dr. Perlman, thank you so much for being on the show. This is great information, and for this season right now, people need to know about it.
Well, it's been my pleasure, Sheila. Thank you so much. It's so nice to spread information and help people.
It is really great. So please share with the viewers how they can find you.
Well, they can visit my website at perlmanmd.com, P-E-R-L-M-A-N-M-D.com, or call us at our Beverly Hills office, which is 310-854-0031. I look forward to meeting you in person.
Thanks so much again for being on the show. And for those of you who want to learn more about the cosmetic and the aesthetic industry, you can visit us online at cosmeticnetworks.com. And until next time, we hope you have a beautiful week.